Skytalkers is a member of the Star Wars Escape Pods Network. Explore more great content and get to know our sister shows at weareescapepods.com and on Twitter at @weareescapepods. The Star Wars Escape Pods Network, promoting positivity in fandom.
The Skywalkers may be the first family of Star Wars, but the meaning of family in a galaxy far, far away is about so much more than the family you're born into. The concept of family within Star Wars is tied up in the tapestry of themes right next to hope.
Welcome to Skytalkers. Here are your hosts, Charlotte and Caitlin.
Hello, and welcome to Skytalkers. I'm your host, Charlotte.
Hey, everyone. I am your other host, Caitlin, and welcome to our show. We're finally back on our regular schedule, and we are talking all about family in Star Wars. I'm really excited for this topic.
I know, me too. And, you know, as we shift away from, it's been like 6 months of talking about films. I feel like I am excited to like dive into talking about Star Wars as a whole again. And I said this when we did our Visions episode, but it really feels like it now since we're like kind of moving through Solo and everything. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I know. We were right before we hit record, we were talking about how this episode is kind of similar to our Visions episode, where we're going to be pulling from all of the films and animation across all of Star Wars. And that's really some of my favorite things to do on our podcast, because I think it's so much fun. And I love these different connections that you can make between all of these films. It's one of the great things about Star Wars.
Totally. And now Caitlin is in upstate New York for her internship. She's no longer staying with me in Boston.
No.
And it's sad.
It is sad. It is sad. So if you're near the Canadian border in New York, look me up. It's so funny. When I tell people that I'm going to New York, everyone's first assumption is just, oh, New York City. And I'm like, no, I'm a good 7 hours away from New York City.
What's funny is that like internships are so tied to New York City. So when you say that you have an internship in New York, like you got to say upstate because it's so different.
Yeah. Well, I'm back at the same place I was last year. And I feel like I've learned my lesson, because last year I was like, oh, I'm going up to New York. I'd be like, oh, New York City. It was that whole conversation. But now I make a point to say upstate New York. And some people like don't really understand that when I say upstate, I really mean like Canada. Like it's just like, no, keep going north further. Nope, almost there. A little bit more. You can see the border. You're there. Like, it's funny. It's funny. So if you're in the area, let me know.
One thing that we haven't talked about is like the mad craziness that was getting Celebration tickets a couple weeks ago.
Lord. Oh, my God.
Well, we got them. We got our 5G passes.
Stressful.
And they're sold out now.
Can't believe it. One that was like that was so stressful because you were at work and I was at the apartment. I was with Charlotte when all of the tickets went on sale, and we were both in like lines, all of the virtual queues. I was trying to explain later that day to my mother a virtual queue, and it was like a really hard conversation.
It's like, if you don't know, then you don't get it.
I know. I was like, no, we were in line. And she was like, what do you mean in line? I was like, I don't really know, but the green man wouldn't move.
Well, what happened is, just like a quick story, because I feel like Caitlin and I complain so much about conventions. But we were in line. Caitlin got sent a link to the hotel. The hotel queue like a couple minutes before the line actually opened.
It was like, and 3 minutes before, because the hotel queue was supposed to open up at 2 o'clock, but you could log on at like 1:55, and it was like, you're in line. And I was like, okay, great. not great.
No. And basically it got you kicked out like right as it hit the 2 o'clock thing?
Well, it kicked me out, and then it put me back in line, but I went through the line really quickly. Like, I was one of the first people in, well, I guess it was like 2:03 or something when I actually got into the hotel thing, and everything was fine, and we were texting, and we were comparing the hotels, and then it like kicked me out, and then it was all downhill from there, and I was so sad.
We got a hotel.
We got a hotel.
Everything. The end of the story is, you know, they released another block after, like, there were no hotels left and we were devastated and stressed. And we got hotels for all the days. And I assume that they just keep releasing blocks. And the thing is that there are many hotels in Chicago, but there's only a certain amount that are tied to the convention and have, like, a convention price.
Or even close to the convention center.
Exactly. And so we were gunning for those. They sold out. Then they were released again. Who knows? Whatever. All that matters is we're really excited because we're going to Celebration in April of next year.
Woo!
And if you guys are going, we definitely want to say hi. We definitely want to do a meetup of some sorts.
Yeah.
I don't know if we're going to do the podcast stage or apply for it or whatever.
People keep asking us about it. And I'm like, we did a panel. We were on a panel at DragonCon, and that was so nerve-wracking. I'm like, to do one at Celebration?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But let us know if you guys are going, because for last Celebration, the podcast was only like 2 months old at that time. So we knew people, but we weren't comfortable enough yet to like do a meetup or like even reach out to like a lot of our online friends. And that's definitely something we want to make a priority next year. So we are super, super pumped for Celebration. I'm going to be graduated, hopefully employed. Like, so much is going to be different. Like, who knows?
Nothing is going to be different.
Or absolutely nothing. And I'll be back in Charlotte's apartment. The same as last year.
Yes, exactly. But, you know, we're just really excited. And let us know if you're going, or let us know if you like desperately want us to do the podcast stage. Maybe all we need is a little encouragement.
I don't know. But let us know.
Yeah. Anyway, we should probably get started.
Yes.
So in part one, we're going to be defining the concept of family in Star Wars.
And in part two, we're going to be touching on some of the themes around family that were brought up in Solo.
And in part three, we're going to be talking about the future of the saga and kind of talk a little bit more about the sequel trilogy and the concept of family there. So without further ado, let's get started.
So who talks first? You talk first? I talk first?
All right, welcome to part one, where we're going to be defining family in Star Wars. And kind of to start us off on this discussion, I think is probably the most appropriate quote we could pull. And it's from Carrie Fisher in one of the behind the scenes for The Last Jedi, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for The Last Jedi. She said, it's about family. That's what makes it so powerful. Let's like dive in a little bit deeper. What exactly does she mean? I mean, has Star Wars always been about family, or has it kind of become that over the years?
The thing is that the original Star Wars was not about family and family blood. It really wasn't. I guess it was because it was a sort of a catalyst for Luke to become a Jedi like his father, sure. But things didn't really change until Empire, where everything was kind of on that axis of Vader telling Luke that he was his father. And in that point, it became like this huge thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is that, yes, it wasn't necessarily about blood until that moment. But the thing that makes Star Wars so good is all these relationships formed in this like found family concept on the Millennium Falcon and with these characters all together.
What's interesting is I think that this particular question kind of goes back to that whole chicken before the egg when it comes to talking about George Lucas and Star Wars. It's like, was everything decided ahead of time? Was it not? How much did he make up as he went along? And the answer is both. Like, he knew that he had this huge saga planned out. And so, I mean, you assume that there was probably, you know, there were all of these foundation storylines that he knew he wanted in there. Probably. But then it became about so much more. And it's like, once you're an Empire, then he's like, then it, you know, it's kind of like you said, it's growing more and more into this family thing. What I love particularly about the original trilogy is that it's kind of the best of both worlds. It's like Luke has this found family and then ends up being his actual family, like his blood family with Leia. I think there's something really cool about that. And this, you know, kind of going back to that like, cosmic force destiny, finding your found family and them actually becoming, you find out that they are your family, if that makes sense.
And I think that the Carrie Fisher quote you know, it hits so hard when she said that at the end of that behind the scenes sizzle reel, because I mean, not only because it was pretty recent after her passing, but the thing that always gets me about Star Wars is how generational it is. And it's generational because it has this uplifting story about family and found family and friendships and love and everything. And it is really, it's about family in all sense of the word. And truly, that's why that quote hits so hard.
Yeah.
And I feel like I might be repeating myself a little bit tonight, but I do think that it bears repeating about how powerful that concept is. When we were putting together the show, I've been watching a lot of old interviews with Kathleen Kennedy, George Lucas, J.J. Abrams, and kind of just revisiting that time period of before, you know, kind of the fan vibe got really, really harsh around The Last Jedi, and kind of going back to that like excitement time around The Force Awakens. And, you know, when they were kind of talking about things in abstract. And I have found that Kathy has talked about, and I don't have the quote in front of me, but a couple of times about how Star Wars, it has stood apart of like other franchises, like big action franchises, in being so much about love and about family and everything. And I really do think that that is the reason why people come back to it time and time again, and that it stands the test of time, because yes, it's myth, it's modern myth, but it's modern myth with this like amazing concept of how important it is to love the people around you, you know?
Well, there's something familiar about this family that has been built over the past four decades. And that's something you don't see. I mean, it's like when you're talking about like the difference between Star Wars and like big action films. I mean, I think the most common comparison right now is the Avengers and Marvel. And it's like you have these pieces of family, but really like the only, and I don't know Marvel as well, but like what I think of when I think of family in Marvel is like Thor and Loki and that's about it. Whereas with Star Wars, like it's so, at this point it is, you know, it is modern myth, and it's it permeates every part of these stories, whether it's backstory about someone's family or it's about finding your family. It really does all come down to that, about seeking your belonging. And that can look like a lot of different things to a lot of different people.
And I think that it is so purposeful that the first full trailer for The Force Awakens had that quote from Luke, you know, the Force is strong in my family, et cetera, you know. And
oh my God, you said et cetera, right?
I know. It's shocking.
No exception.
Yeah. But I think that it's no mistake that you know, brought back this like new age of the franchise, because it is so well known that that's what makes this so special.
What I think is interesting is that it's like The Last Jedi has really been honing in on this idea of family. And I know the first time I heard that little snippet from Carrie Fisher, you know, it's about family, that's what makes it so powerful, my first like short-sighted thought, of course, was about Ben Solo. And I was like, Princess Leia is talking about family, she's talking about her kid. And that's where my mind went to. But it's like when you zoom out and you really look at it on this big picture, it is about family, and there is something really powerful about that. And what's great now about how diverse Star Wars is that you get to see a lot of definitions of what family is. And I know that's especially true when it comes to these anthology films and to animation, which are separate from the, you know, quote unquote, first family of Star Wars, the Skywalkers.
Why don't we dive right into like the animation and the anthology films?
Yeah.
I think it's pretty clear that Rebels is maybe the most profound example of found family.
Definitely.
Within Star Wars at this point. And I don't want to spoil it, because I do think that you can listen to this conversation without like watching the end of Rebels, and I'm not going to, but I think that, you know, they always refer to like Kanan and Hera are like the parents, and Ezra, Sabine, and Zeb are like the kids, and they often refer to them as such. It's actually adorable.
It's one of the cutest things. I mean, Ezra, Ezra and Zeb even have that. It's in the first season. One of their first episodes together is Hera sending them out on this like shopping list, like a grocery run, basically, for them to learn how to work together. And like they share a bedroom with bunk beds. And like it's just like they're like siblings who have to learn how to get along with each other. It's very familial.
And the thing is that if that show didn't have these kind of dynamics, it wouldn't feel Star Wars-y. Mm-hmm. And I know we talk a lot about like what's the Star Wars feeling. And I feel like that's the Star Wars feeling. Like overall, it really is. Characters have to relate to each other in a way that like makes you feel good about yourself because they're just so happy together and they're stronger together, right?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting comparison though between Rebels and Clone Wars, because Clone Wars doesn't have, I mean, do you think Clone Wars has that same kind of family vibe that Rebels has?
Well, I think it's weird that you bring that up because I do think that like the Anakin and Obi-Wan relationship is so familial to the point where it's like, oh, he's like my father, he's my brother, everything like that. And that is said in Attack of the Clones, then Revenge of the Sith, and then only expanded upon in Clone Wars. So much so that we even see this, you talk about it all the time, like Ahsoka being Anakin's apprentice. It's like the first time you could potentially see Anakin as a father.
Yeah, I totally agree. But it's almost like these relationships in Clone Wars are more isolated. Like when I think of like family units, I don't think of, as much as I love all the missions of Obi-Wan, Anakin, and Ahsoka together, I don't think of them as a family unit. I think of them as like a Jedi unit, whereas I think of like the Rebels crew as a family unit.
Perhaps that's the, you know, the prequels are flawed and not in the fact that you know, as everyone says, like the prequels suck. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the prequels kind of show like fragmented, flawed people and everything. Mm-hmm. And it's, you look at that and you're right. They're isolated. And then we see like everything kind of building to this like great strength of a crew. And like we see in Rogue One, even in Solo, right? And in Rebels. And we'll get into Solo. I think Solo is a little bit more complicated than that. But I think that Rebels is kind of that huge strength of like these people shouldn't be isolated, and when they're isolated, they're not at their best.
Yeah, and it's kind of like the Jedi are kind of forcing these relationships on people, but they can't, you know, that's the whole thing of the Jedi is like you are tied to this person, to this apprentice, this master, what have you, but like don't be too tied. You know, don't be too attached. I mean, that great episode in Clone Wars with Luminara and Barriss, the Geonosis episode where Barriss and Ahsoka are trapped underneath and Anakin is like freaking out and Luminara is like, we have to let them go. And Anakin's like, I won't abandon her. And Luminara says like this great line where she's like, unlike you, Skywalker, I know like when to say goodbye. And, you know, it's pointing out that Anakin doesn't know how to do that. And of course, we all know he doesn't. But it's like their relationships are a product of their time. And it's like Anakin and Padme never get to that like homely place because their relationship is built on secrecy. And so there's always that tinge of, oh, what if they're found out, blah, 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 like all around their scene, most of their scenes together, obviously not all. But there's always that kind of underlying vibe. It can never get to that, you know, like Sabine drawing graffiti on Zeb and Ezra's walls. Like you're not going to have that same kind of humor and comfort level in Clone Wars like you would have in Rebels due to the situations that those characters were in.
Definitely. So is family like really all about blood then? I know we've talked about this, but like what does that mean to you and how do we really define family then?
I think like I said earlier, this like era of Star Wars is building on everything that's come before it, and this idea that like however you define family, whether it's blood family or found family, you know, both are important and both can be like guiding stars in your life. And I really do think that Rebels is the best example of that because where we see Ezra in the beginning of Rebels, he's broken over the loss of his blood family, but then he has this found family. And like I said, we won't do spoilers, but that's something that's brought up a lot throughout Rebels is, you know, Ezra kind of mourning and remembering and trying to honor his blood family while growing, while also doing the same, feeling the same way about his found family and him learning that both are infinitely important to him.
Right. And it is, no spoilers, but he does continue to refer to the ghost crew as his new family. Mm-hmm. And it is really beautiful.
It really is. I think that really is one of the biggest strengths of Rebels.
Okay, so let's go to Rogue One, because I think Rogue One is kind of a different example of found family, right? Because the entire movie is also guided by the fact that Jin, it starts off like Jin experiencing, you know, the terror of her family being taken away from her
and kind then of like forced to into life. Ezra.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. I think one of the differences between Rebels and Rogue One is that Rebels is kind of this found family. Rogue One is kind of this forged family.
Yes.
Because there isn't – that's one of the, like, tragedies and one of the points of Rogue One is that there isn't time for them to become anything more than they are in the moments that we're with them. There is no past or future for these characters together. All they have mm-hmm. is this moment. And that, like, forges this incredible bond between them, which is at once so immediate and intimate, which is what we see with Cassian and Jin, but it's so brief because, yes. you know, they die.
Indeed. I do think there's that beautiful moment where Baze takes Jin's hand and calls her little sister. Mm-hmm. And that's before they go to Scarif or anything.
Yeah.
And it really just is establishing this idea that at the end of this, they will all go into this one mission together. And all these different people mean something to each other. Despite, I think it's a little bit more isolationist, like a little bit more Clone Wars than it is Rebels.
Yeah.
But I do think that the reason why the end of Rogue One works so much is because you understand that all these people are together in this forged family, to use the word that you use, to accomplish this one specific goal.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting because this is one of the... If you guys don't know, one of the Rogue One, talking about Rogue One was right when we started Skytalkers. It was because we were a little bit frustrated at some of the discourse we were seeing about Rogue One, because a lot of people were critiquing the characterization of Rogue One. And Charlotte and I both felt completely opposite of that. And we were like, this is the time we're starting a podcast and we're going to talk about Rogue One because we love it. us. But I remember one of the things that people would point is to this moment that you're talking about is Baze calling Jin little sister. And everyone was like, that makes no sense. He's like said two words to her, blah, blah, blah. It's not good. And it's like, it's bad characterization. And I remember thinking like, no, that's the point. It's a forged family. They're in this live and die situation and they all know how important it is. And in that moment, it's like, for as important as the mission is, they're all as important to each other too, even in this short time, because they all know that, you know, this is the end. And these mm-hmm. are the people that they're with. These are the people that have chosen to go on this mission to fulfill this, in the words of Snoke, to fulfill this destiny. wow, that Snoke line came out of nowhere and I don't know how I feel about that. But like that's the point of like that's the underlying point of Rogue One is that it is so tragic because their time together is so brief, but they do feel so deeply for each other.
Just as an aside, at the risk of like kind of beating a dead horse, I find that discourse about like the characterization in Rogue One to be sad because I found myself so attached to these characters and mm-hmm. was like openly weeping at the end of that movie.
Oh, I know.
So much so that I did not expect it. And I think there's something there where you recognize this like one group sacrifice when the shield doors like close on what is it called?
The shield doors.
Yeah, the shield doors. When they close on the planet and you know that they're stuck there forever, mm-hmm. it's like,
ugh,
oh my God.
The shadow of the Death Star and the music. Yeah. Oh my God.
But the reason why it works, and yes, it's the music, it's the visuals and everything, but it works because you have spent this entire movie that's quite long, you know, building to this point of realizing that they're all in this together.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's familial. It is.
Yeah. And like, as an aside on like the Rogue One characterizations, which at some point Charlotte and I will do, we do have a breakdown of Rogue One from like the very beginning of our podcast, but I don't recommend it. It's not very good. So at some point we're going to redo one. But it's like, you know, to have good characters, I don't need to know every moment that Baze and Jin have talked to each other in the past, you know, 3 days that they've known each other. I consider good characterization when I feel something about the things that they're doing, and when I've been moved emotionally. And for me, that's a mark of a good character. And all of the characters in Rogue One did that for me. And so it all makes sense. But it's I really like I haven't really thought about this until we started talking about it, but the comparison between Jin and Ezra, because they both have this loss of their blood family, to then creating a found and a forged family.
Wow.
I know. It's sad. And I think
it's great. It's a great parallel because they're both experiencing things at this time period in history, you know, and it works because of that.
Okay. I want to bring up a comparison between Jin and Ezra and like Rebels versus Rogue One, but it like gets a little spoilery. So I would skip ahead about like 3 to 4 minutes, because I'm just going to talk a little bit about kind of the finale. So Rebels, spoiler warning here. Okay. So I'm kind of interested in following this like thought process of comparing Jin and Ezra a little bit, because like, let's say, and like the impact of these families, because with Rebels, we have so much time with that crew. But as we've discussed with the Rogue One crew, like they've affected us pretty deeply and emotionally, despite only having one film with them. So like, how do you think it would compare if like Rebels had ended with like the entire Ghost crew sacrificing themselves in some kind of similar final mission, final lesson situation like Rogue One does?
Okay, so in a world where there's no Rogue One, is that your question?
No, I guess just maybe. I don't really know what my question is.
I think that if without Rogue One, it would have worked for the Ghost crew. I think it would have. Especially if it was like for Lothal. If with Rogue One, it doesn't work because it just doesn't work. It doesn't have as big of an impact. And the epilogue of Rebels is inspirational. It's joyous. The fact that most of them survive. Like I feel like that is what that show needed, especially with that family. And it shows that their resiliency and their ability to come together like continues throughout all this huge war. And it's really important that that show does that in a way that Rogue One, all these people diverging at this one point to accomplish this one mission together. It's just different. It's really different to me.
Yeah. Yeah. I think you're right. I just kind of wanted to follow that line of thought a little bit, because it is interesting the Jin and Ezra comparison now that we've kind of talked through it a little more, because I hadn't really thought about it before now.
Totally. Okay, well, I'm really itching to talk about Solo in this theme of family, so let's move on to part two.
Okay.
So welcome to part two. We're going to be talking about Solo, so hopefully you've seen it. If not, spoiler warning, head to part three. I have been thinking a lot about Solo lately, and kind of the catalyst of wanting to talk about this theme of family has been the conversation really around the whole, how did Han get his name? I think the whole like conception of his name is like kind of not the best.
I mean, like the original, like George Lucas, like he's on his own, he's Solo.
No, I mean in
universe,
in the film. Yeah. In universe. I think it's just like, it's a little kitschy, but I do have to like bring in an, you know, a thematic reason why it works. Obviously it works because Han Solo is on his own. It is like part of who he is, right? He is Solo.
Yeah.
Kind of. It's a little questionable. I think that the whole question that the Imperial officer asks him, which is, who are your people? Han goes, I have no people. And I think it's so interesting, like, once you kind of break down this, it's like, you know, outside of Star Wars, like we would have said, someone would have said, what's your last name, right? Who mm-hmm. are you? Who is your family? Instead, the emphasis is on people. And I find that really in line with our conversation about how like family can be from blood, but it can also be this found family concept of all these people coming together. Mm-hmm. And it's like, does it go back to Han's experience with the white worms? Like, would his last name potentially have been Han of the white worms?
Oh, like Han White Worm.
Maybe something like that. You know what I mean? Or yeah. like, you know, Rey is Rey, no last name, but of Jakku. Like, maybe it would have been something like that.
Yeah.
But I do think there's really something there about him saying, who are your people?
Yeah. Well, just to kind of, for a point of comparison, so I was in anthropology major in my undergraduate life. And we talk a lot about like definition of place, which is something I do a lot in my graduate work too, and like how people like their cultures and how they talk about their lives and each other. And one of the things that is really different in different parts of the world is how people ask like who you are, which I think is really interesting. Like in Star Wars, in this instance, it's like, who are your people? But in different cultures, that question looks differently because those definitions of family are different. It's like, where is your land? Or like, who are your people? Where's your tribe? Like, mm-hmm. where do you come from? And like, those are all signifiers of who you are. Right. And it's not always this, like what we would consider like a traditional Western definition of like, my family is my mother and my father, and that is who I am, you know. But in these different places, it looks and is defined in different ways, just as it, you know, as it kind of is here in Star Wars too.
Definitely. And I think that I just think it's purposeful that it says that they say, who are your people, not mm-hmm. who are your family.
Yeah.
And I do think it underscores a little bit about, you know, we talked about in our last episode, our Solo breakdown, how we kind of struggled with finding a theme of Solo. Mm-hmm. I do think that a major theme of Solo is Han trying to find his family and
seeking his belonging, you might say.
Yes, exactly. And that's why, you know, he has so many comparisons to Rey, no last name, whatever, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. But that is a major component of Solo in general, the film. Mm-hmm. And it in hindsight, it's kind of ridiculous that we, you know, went over it. But here we are doing basically a whole episode about it.
We're doing it now.
But I think like, and we may have mentioned this in our breakdown, but I think maybe the most Star Wars-y quote in Solo is when they're all sitting around the fire, which Caitlin, I think you've expressed is like one of your favorite scenes.
I think it's one of my favorite. It's definitely one of my favorite Star Wars scenes, and I think it's my favorite scene in Solo, particularly.
Yeah,
there's just something so lovely about it.
And it's so lovely because it's so Star Wars-y,
right?
And it has that Star Wars feeling of everyone coming together, talking about like their interests and their passions, mm-hmm. and you know, and it's
you've got aliens, you've got dubious do-gooders,
and like impending doom.
Got everything.
Like, we laugh at the impending doom, but like that's a huge part of Star Wars too.
Tragedy.
Yeah. But you know, there's that line where they're talking about what they're gonna do with the money, and Chewie like garbles something, and Han translates it, and he's like, I don't know if he said family or tribe. And Becca goes, what's the difference?
So great. Such a great moment.
It like gives me chills because it is so Star Wars-y, and like I can't believe we haven't had that line before mm-hmm. in Star Wars, you know?
Yeah.
And it kind of just underscores like the whole no people thing. Han
yeah.
has no people, and it's what's the difference between people, family, and tribe, right?
Yeah.
It's all the same.
It's what you make of it.
Yeah. And I mean, just going back to like the themes of Solo and him trying to find his family, he tries to find, you know, that sense of belonging, that sense of togetherness with Kira. And clearly that's not the answer. He tries to find this like sense of purpose with the crew when they're on Mimbam, right?
Yes.
I don't know. Wrong planet.
I think
the mud planet.
That's the mud planet.
Yeah,
the mud troopers.
Rio and everyone, it's just not going to work. Beckett was going to betray him, was going to kill him. Mm-hmm. Thinks that maybe potentially he could like have this life or kind of work for Crimson Dawn. Doesn't really work out that way either. You know, Han is the good guy, but can't potentially find his like belonging, his place, his family.
Yeah.
And the only person that he finds it in is Chewbacca, which is why his relationship with Chewie lasts like 30, 40 years, right?
Quite a long time. Yeah. What I love about like this aspect of Solo is that it's like we know that these aren't his people. And that, you know, like there's something that's not quite there because it's not supposed to be.
Right.
Because like his like ride or die people are going are not here yet. And mm-hmm. it's like even and it does attest to like this change in time too, that like families and people change, you know, however you define family, it changes. Like Han talks about, you know, his mother, or he talks about his father. And like clearly that was a relationship that was important to him, but changed. Whether through Han's fault, his father's fault, the Empire, we don't really know at this point. But something changed down the line where he still has this like love, and I think only like a father-son kind of love can have, but there's distance there. And it's the same with Kira too. Like he, like we talked about, like he has this idea of who she was and he wants that back. But the truth of the matter is she's changed and so has he. And so they're not each other's tribe anymore. Something's mm-hmm. happened, and that's not always a bad thing.
Right. In this case, I think it kind of is a bad thing just based off of like Kira's background and everything.
Yeah.
But I do think that it's obvious, like knowing Han's character arc, obviously you need to get through this in order mm-hmm. to find his Luke and Leia
yeah.
family.
I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. Like, it's bad the situation, like, what happened to Kira.
That's what I mean.
Yeah, it would have been bad if she had gone with him, even without the, like, Crimson Dawn component of it, and them, like, trying to be these people that they no longer are.
Yeah, for sure.
That would have been bad. Sure. But I get what you're saying. Like, the situation, like, she shouldn't have ever had to be in that situation.
Exactly. Yeah. But I do, it's great because, you know, he tries to find his sense of belonging and inevitably finds it in two people who are family, right. Like blood family. And then he marries into that family.
That's great.
Like, it's just great.
What's cool is that for as much as we like highlight the Skywalker family and we talk about how, you know, Ben is still a Skywalker, even if that's not his name, but like he takes after his father in that like father-son relationship. Like the way that Han kind of talks about his father in Solo, I think it's obviously not the same, but I think it's comparable to how Ben talks about his father. Mm-hmm. Like you can totally see where if that scene where Han and Lando are talking and, you know, he's talking about how his father built ships and was a pilot and he's like, but he was a disappointment in the end. Mm-hmm. You can kind of see that line coming from Han in Solo. And then, of course, Ben says that to Kylo, says that to Rey, you know, he would have disappointed you. But he didn't want to kill him. So there was, you know, there is, I mean, obviously, like, the saga films are so much more dramatic than I think Solo was ever going to be. But it needed to be. Yeah, exactly. But I think there is that comparison to be made there that, like, even though Ben is a Skywalker, he is his father's son.
Definitely. For sure. I think that, like, goes without saying almost,
mm-hmm.
you know? And you see those kind of comparisons come up in Solo and the extra canon material, anything.
Yes.
So anything more that we want to say about Solo in terms of family?
I guess they're all, you know, everyone's just trying to put together a crew the best they can.
It's literally a theme. I know, you know, I joked a while back that, like, my favorite line in Solo is Big Shot Gangster putting together a crew, obviously. But it's kind of a theme. I know it's kind of a throwaway line. But the whole concept of putting together a crew is like Han's like goal, essentially.
It's really funny.
Right? And I think that's great. And that's obviously like we laugh about it because it's like, oh, it was like a throwaway line at the end of the movie about Jabba the Hutt. Mm-hmm. And Jabba wasn't even a part of this movie. But it's still like a high key concept that obviously the marketing people like recognized because of course it is. You know, there's all these people that are coming together and yes, it doesn't work.
No,
it really doesn't work.
I think that concept was like some intern somewhere just like got a good kick out of that line and was like, use it. Use it and abuse it.
It's great.
It's funny.
Okay, so let's talk about the sequel trilogy.
Yes.
Listen, big deal. You got another problem. Women always figure out the truth. Always.
All right, welcome to part three, where we're talking about the future of family in Star Wars. And obviously, we're going to be touching on the sequel trilogy here. So where do we kind of think this concept of found blood and forged family is going in the sequel trilogy?
I think it's all going to converge. And mm-hmm. I feel like that is my answer for most things about episode 9 at this point, of like, oh, like, it's all going to come together.
Yeah.
But I really do think it is. I think there's going to be an equal emphasis on family and like the Skywalker blood as much as there is like found family. Mm-hmm. And as, you know, people who are very interested in the Rey and Kylo dynamic, I think that those concepts are going to come together with them, as they kind of already started to in The Last Jedi.
Yeah, it is. It's kind of like with Leia and Luke. Like, it is this convergence of blood and found family and like mm-hmm. becoming family. But it's converging with the Skywalker family too.
Yeah, I mean, to me, it's like that's as big as the concept of family is in Star Wars. It's as big as hope. And I feel like these two, you know, extremely prevalent concepts are definitely going to come together to like prove that, like, I don't know, some sort of like joyous celebration of everything kind of working out, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
But I do think that we have to like go, like, take a step back before we talk about the future and just kind of discuss like each of the characters, like Rey and Finn and Poe, and like, where do they come from in terms of family?
Mm-hmm. Well, they're all, I mean, that's kind of the weird thing about the sequel trilogy, is that the crew, as it were, is in a lot of ways a lot more disjointed than even like our prequel trilogy relationships, like mm-hmm. Anakin and Ahsoka and Anakin and Obi-Wan and Padme and everything, because they all obviously, like, Rey and Finn have the strongest relationship at this point, and having come from like a no family background and having been like abandoned more or less. I don't think Finn was abandoned, but like
he was taken from his family.
Yeah, yeah. And like Rey's situation was just as traumatic. Just a little different. Like, she was given away, mm-hmm. sold. And it's sad, and you want them to have that found family together. But then we have these other characters who are becoming more and more important, but they're kind of more loosely drawn. And I don't necessarily mean that in a bad way, but like Poe, there's not a lot we know about him. We do have his comic, which delves a lot into his family life. But as far as from like a saga standpoint, like the films, there isn't a lot there, because he was supposed to die in the beginning of Force Awakens. But then with Rose too, we have this tragedy of Paige. So they're all kind of marked by this tragedy within their families.
I think it's really a step that Disney has been doing. It's very Disney-esque in a way. I don't like to say Disney. I shouldn't say Disney, but I will, because it's all these new characters are marked by something in their childhood.
Yeah.
Whether it's, you know, Rey being left by her parents, or Finn being taken by a family that, you know, by the First Order, taken from a family he'll never know.
Yeah.
Poe, you're right. We don't really know much about him in movie. Like, obviously we know about Cher Bay and everyone, but through the comics, but even still, like, they died. And then we have Ben, who was clearly marked and preyed upon by Snoke when he was young and had his uncle stand above him in bed, right?
Yeah.
And then we have Jyn Erso, who, when she was like 6 or so, her parents were murdered right in front of her, right? Her mom mm-hmm. was murdered, and then her dad was taken from her, dies later. And we have Han Solo, who lives a scrum rat life, right? So we have these characters now, and even Ezra, you know, mm-hmm. these new characters who are all marked by something in their childhood. And it is very fairy tale-esque. And I think that that's important to remember, because, mm-hmm. And you know, this is not unlike what we had in the original trilogy either. Like, you know, Anakin Skywalker, original trilogy, I say original trilogy and they go straight for Anakin. But I mean, I feel like we have this with all of our characters, save for Padme. Mm-hmm. But I think that it is quite a statement for literally every single character that they introduce into canon to have this kind of background. Yeah. And it becomes increasingly important for them to understand the importance of loving those around them.
Yeah, it's what I think is cool about the sequel trilogy and like this idea of everything kind of converging together at the end again, like both found, forged, and blood family, is that it's like with the Skywalkers, you kind of get the best of both worlds, because it's like Ben has had this traumatic childhood and upbringing brought on by a lot of different factors, himself included, but his family is still there. And so there's this chance, I mean, obviously we don't know what's going to happen in episode 9 with Leia, but originally, if we kind of take a step back, originally there was this like potential for reconciliation, just like there was in episode 6 with Luke and Vader. And I think that there'll be, you know, if Ben Solo is to be redeemed in some form or fashion, I think there will be like some mention, depending on how things go with Leia, of like his blood family forgiving him. And of course, we have the potential of like a Luke or an Anakin Force Ghost situation for something like that to be brought up. And then it's like, then he has this opportunity to be reconciled, hopefully on some level, with his blood family, and then have this found family, whether it's, you know, in a romantic relationship with Rey or just in like a belonging with Rey as like powerful Force wielders, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's like, we can see both of these things coming together. And then, you know, if it did go the like romantic Reylo route, Rey has the found family of like Finn and Poe and the Resistance, and then, you know, becomes a blood family with Kylo, with Ben.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
So you do get the best of both worlds. Can I, okay, just to kind of, and since we haven't really talked a ton about Vader, but someone had posted this excerpt today from the Return of the Jedi novelization, right, on Twitter. Did you see this?
I did. Do you want to read it?
I do. I like just thought of it. And I think it's this really great moment of, it's the end of Return of the Jedi and Vader kind of talking about Obi-Wan and Luke Skywalker, which I think is great because, you know, those are two branches of his family, as it were. So this is an excerpt from Return of the Jedi, the novelization, which I don't think either of us have read. Have you read it?
Yeah, of course I've read it. Okay. I read all of them.
A little mean.
It's been a really long time, though.
As like, per usual, Charlotte shaming me for things I haven't read.
It's been so long. And the thing is that those novelizations, like, they're really old, yeah, you know? What you're going to read has value, don't get me wrong, but it's not the same sort of prose that you get with Revenge of the Sith.
All right. Well, you're making me feel bad about not having read it. Two, you're making me feel bad that this, like, isn't Revenge of the Sith level. So let me just say.
I backtrack. It's a good one. I remember reading it.
Whatever. Okay. I'm going to read it. Just hush. All right. This is an excerpt, an excellent excerpt from Return of the Jedi. And this memory brought a wave of other memories with it. Memories of brotherhood and home, his dear wife, the freedom of deep space, Obi-Wan, his friend, and how that friendship had turned, he knew not how, but got injected nonetheless with some uncaring virulence that festered until, hold, these were memories he wanted none of, not now, memories of molten lava crawling up his back, no, this boy had pulled him from that pit, here, now, with this act, this boy was good, the boy was good, and the boy had come from him, so there must have been good in him, too. He smiled up again at his son, and for the first time, loved him. And for the first time in many long years, loved himself again as well. I think there's like so much in there. I mean, even at the end, like loved himself again. My first thought was of like Kira and her situation. And, mm-hmm. you know, like there was good in him. He even talks about Padme and how it's like he was still living in that lava pit and he felt in a way abandoned by Obi-Wan, even though he kind of recognized that, you know, that darkness had taken a hold of him, that even Obi-Wan couldn't help him at that point. But like Luke pulled him from that lava pit. And there's mm-hmm. something just like really great about that.
That symbolism of Luke pulling him from the lava pit that you said kind of it harkens back to the fact that he even has his castle on Mustafar. He's like forever mm-hmm. yeah. writhing in this pain.
Yeah.
And it's not until Luke that he feels that he could escape that.
Yeah. Yeah. I really like that comparison and that connection.
And in that way, blood family, the Skywalkers, are so powerful.
Yeah.
It took Luke to take Vader back to Anakin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know? And it took, obviously, it's not Luke that redeems Vader. We've talked about this before. It's Anakin realizing his potential. It's Anakin realizing mm-hmm. that he could love somebody, that he had that within him, that this person is so good and he is part of him.
Yeah, exactly.
And it couldn't be more powerful than that.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think it brings up, I mean, we kind of have to talk about this when we're talking about family, but like the potential end of the Skywalker line. And there are mm-hmm. a lot of people in the community that are like really ready for that, for the Skywalker story, the Skywalker saga to be done. No more Skywalkers. Obviously, a lot of people see this with like Kylo Ren dying. And it's just like it's over and done with. And I think that's something we do have to talk about. But I know for us, we're both like such Skywalker stans all around. Like
every single one of them.
All of our top favorite characters are all Skywalkers. But like the idea of that happening at this point in time, we're both like, no. No, never. But, you know, if we could like take a step back and kind of take off our Skywalker goggles, do we think that has... Like, what does that mean? Like, if Kylo Ren does die at the end of episode 9, what does that mean for this theme of family?
Well, the thing is that, like, I don't know how he would die. I think it all depends on how his death is portrayed. Does he die as Kylo Ren? Does he die as Ben Solo? Because those two things are very separate for me.
Yeah. Okay. So let's take it one at a time. Let's say he dies as Kylo Ren.
Bad. Really bad. Yeah. It's so hopeless. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely the most hopeless thing possible. Leia and Rey both being wrong about him. It proves to me that someone who was in a terrible situation, who was so self-destructive, cannot get himself out despite being continuously self-destructive.
Yeah, I completely agree.
I think that is like a terrible mythological theme and just shouldn't be explored.
Yeah, I completely agree because So then to take it the next step, like if he were to die as Ben Solo, like obviously that's not how you want the story to end, but that is the better possibility of the two because, you know, it's like if Kylo Ren dies Kylo Ren and like lost to this darkness, like I just thinking about it from a 9-story saga of the Skywalker film story ending with episode 9 and for him to have died as Kylo Ren, it's like you go through all of these journeys with all of these Skywalkers who go through these ebbs and flows of light and darkness, but all eventually come to the light at the end. And then for it all to actually and finally end with darkness, it's like, why did I just invest in this family for... you know, 9 films now to have it all be kind of pointless in the end. And I think that's what I always go back to when thinking about like when trying to think unemotionally about Kylo Ren versus Ben Solo as like a big Kylo Ren fan. It's like from that really big picture perspective, it doesn't seem to make a lot of sense. And then even from like a smaller picture, it's like, well, what does like you said earlier, what does this say about Rey and Leia and Han and Luke? Like it proves all of them wrong and it like diminishes their role in the sequel trilogy.
Yeah, it's just so nihilistic and yeah. I hate it.
Yeah.
The thing is that it would make me, if we walked out of the theater and that had happened, I would be like, and I don't want to be this kind of person, but I would be. I'd be like, give me back my ending of Return of the Jedi, where like everything was, you know, things were happy and people were forgiven and all was right in the galaxy.
There was a bittersweetness, but it was earned.
Yeah.
And again, like the focus wasn't on the galaxy's feelings because we've talked about that too. Like is, you know, obviously the galaxy hasn't forgiven Vader. We see that in Bloodline. Mm-hmm. But the interesting thing about the way that movie works out is that Luke has forgiven Vader and the Force has forgiven Vader.
Yes, the cosmic force.
The cosmic force has forgiven Vader, which I think is a really interesting like thought that I don't know.
The Force was balanced.
The Force was balanced. when I think that's an interesting thought process when you're talking about like the difference between redemption and like atonement, because that's a big conversation when it comes to Kylo Ren, is like, well, does he deserve it? Can he earn it? Like, he'll just sit in space jail for the rest of his life, and like that's what should happen. Whereas that wasn't Vader. Obviously had a very different experience, and like, how do you compare those two? Which I think we'll find out.
I mean, I feel like I could talk about this all night, but I do think that, okay, so now let's explore the other side of, like, Ben Solo dying.
Yeah.
So Ben comes back, and he, you know, doesn't resist that call to the light anymore, and potentially he could sacrifice himself for, you know, the greater good, whether that's Rey, whether that's the resistance as a whole, it's probably would be some combination of the two, right? Yeah. And I think that that has the potential to be beautiful in the same way that Vader's death was. But I do feel like it might be a little repetitive of what happened in Return of the Jedi, which is why I feel like having these characters who are young, I mean, it's easy to forget when we talk about these things, like Vader was an old man. Mm-hmm. And so we have these two characters, right? Rey and Kylo Ren, who are, you know, they're like 10 years apart, whatever, but they're young. And it is clear to me that these two people could come together, and like Ben could do things for good and spend the rest of his life, you know, being the best he could possibly be. Mm-hmm. And for me, that is way more hopeful than like this character who is, you know, consistently, like I said, being self-destructive and is very triggered by certain things. And I'm not making excuses for him at all. I'm just, you know, looking at this character for who he is.
Yeah.
And I just don't see it going that way.
I know. I mean, obviously, I agree with you. and you mean, you guys know we obviously have a bias towards this particular storyline. So, you know, if that's not your bias, then just take it with a grain of salt. But yeah, I think it is repetitive. And this is something we talked about, you know, if Ben Solo dies just like Vader does. And this is an interesting component we talked about in our Visions episode, about like how there's always this miscommunication in regards to like visions in the future. And it's always between these generations. So it's usually like an older master or mentor and a younger like student, as it were. And they like don't know how to communicate with each other, which is why it's so abnormal with the sequel trilogy to have these two like powerful force users that are of the same time. And so mm-hmm. they communicate with each other differently, and the potential for what they could do in the future is a lot different.
Totally.
Obviously, like if Ben Solo dies redeemed, then that is the end of the Skywalker line, as it were. And I don't have a problem at all with like more stories about like if episode 9 is the end of the Skywalker line or the end of Skywalker stories for the time being, I'm totally fine with that. I don't need every movie to be about the Skywalkers. Obviously, I love them, but I don't need every film to be about them, especially once we start getting into like Rian Johnson having like his whole trilogy and like new live action and Resistance and everything. Like, I'm ready for those new Star Wars families. From a business standpoint, I can't see Disney/Lucasfilm like getting rid of that potential for the future, for like actual blood Skywalkers. Even if they totally have no agree. Like immediate plans to do anything with that. And even if it's like never a Reylo situation, I like, you can't pay for that kind of name recognition in companies today. Like Skywalker, like everyone knows what you're talking about. And to however you feel about the characters, it's like to just like get rid of the last one so that you completely cut off that avenue. To me, that doesn't make sense from a business standpoint, you know?
I think that a lot of people I agree with you. It doesn't make sense. I think a lot of people are like, the Skywalker name should die because they're afraid of things like the original trilogy continue to be like sullied by new films. and like the mythos of the saga being a little bit tainted by like the sheer volume of the films being created. I just disagree because I feel like these movies are just going to be a part of us forever.
Yeah.
And I feel like we can't stop that. And yeah. I want more Star Wars stories. And I'm perfectly fine, like you said, with taking a break and having Rian Johnson's trilogy and everything. But I just don't see them doing it either. But, you know, people do talk about, like, Rey, which this is an interesting conversation in the conversation about family. People do talk about, like, so Kylo Ren dies, Ben Solo dies, however that happens. And then Rey, with no last name, takes on the mantle of the Skywalker legend because she is part of the story.
She is.
I think that's powerful in itself, but because it really goes back to this whole, like, theme of anyone can be a hero, and she earned her place in it. Obviously, the lightsaber called to her. Everything is kind of aligned. The cosmic force chose her. I just, like, I feel like they can bring that to, like, a greater crescendo than just that. It needs, yeah, like, more to me.
I think for people, like, in our section of fandom who, like, think about this, like, all the time, like, that's a really easy leap to make. Like, oh, Rey, like, just adopts the Skywalker name, and, like, that is enough. You know, like, the Skywalker mm-hmm. name can just be synonymous with legend. It doesn't have to be tied directly to a bloodline. And I mean, I'm kind of on the same page as you. Like, I get that, but I don't know, like, how easily that would be conveyed in film, especially for, like, general audiences. And maybe this is me, like, handholding. I feel like this is a conversation we've been having a lot in the fandom, is, like with the Maul situation. Like, is it too confusing for them? Like, would audiences be confused or not turned off, but just like, oh, I guess she's going by Rey Skywalker now?
I think it would be a little confusing, especially with, like, who's her parents?
Exactly. And she doesn't. And the thing is, it's like, even though she has obviously a connection with Leia, she hasn't spent a lot of time with Leia. Her time with Luke, while ultimately helpful, was not exactly warm. Mm-hmm. And then depending on how things ended with Kylo or Ben, he goes by Ben Solo. So, like, because that's the person she has. Like, Han and Kylo are the people she has the strongest connections to right now from, like, that Skywalker line. And they're both Solos, like, mm-hmm. with their, like, Ben doesn't go by Ben Skywalker Solo. He goes by Ben Solo. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I think that would be logistically a little confusing. I get the sentiment of it. But then I think it kind of goes against this idea of, like, who Rey is, that, like, she is a nobody. She doesn't need to be a Skywalker.
Exactly.
Yeah, which is why, like, that's, like, kind of the mythos level of, like, the Reylo relationship, I think, is that, like, you have the legend of that line with Skywalker represented in Ben, but then you also have the, you know, the hero from nowhere with Rey, and how they're both valuable and both necessary in this, like, world.
Yep. Yes. And them coming together is truly the way that the story should end and the story should be.
Yeah. I can see a situation where it's, like, kind of, like, as far as, like, explicitly, like, romantic Reylo, I can see a situation where that's kind of left in the air for, again, like, something down the line if they've mm-hmm. wanted to. Obviously, as, like, a shipper, I don't want that, but I set myself up for that. And then anything else is just like, yes.
Exactly.
But that's, I mean, I can definitely see that being kind of the ending as far as, like, their relationship is concerned. But they've put in the sequel trilogy, they've put such an emphasis on, like, this idea of, like, destiny and the cosmic force. They've explored those themes so much more. And this idea of, like, balance and, like, light and dark, that it seems kind of weird that they wouldn't kind of cement their relationship, whether it's romantically or it's just, like, they're the two most powerful force users kind of thing.
Yeah.
I feel like they have to kind of define their relationship pretty concretely based on the, like, the details about the force and, like, this time period that we've been getting so far from, like, extra material.
Exactly.
And from within the films themselves, obviously.
Yeah, it's very deep, the whole yin and yang concept. And if they were to go their separate ways, I don't think that it would be as powerful as that theme of light and dark, yin and yang, you know, opposites, right?
Yeah. And that's what we say about The Last Jedi. Like, the best moment for the world in that movie was when they were working together. That's when everything was going correctly. The Force theme played, like, all cylinders were firing.
It was perfectly balanced. Yeah. Yeah. And then everything went wrong.
Yeah, because it's, you know, darker middle chapter.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Darker middle chapter. Hashtag darker middle chapter. So clearly, like, the cosmic force, like, don't care about that family, really. Like, they recognize that the Skywalkers are extremely powerful, but the cosmic force chose Rey to assist in this, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, be a major crucial part of, like, balancing the force.
Yes. I think they talk about it. Jason Fry does a great little bit in the Last Jedi novelization where he talks about the cosmic force. And it's like how it chose the Skywalkers and has been choosing the Skywalkers. And now it's choosing someone else too. But it's not mm-hmm. because it's like abandoning the Skywalkers. It's just adding more to the mix. And I think that's what's kind of cool about this part of the story right now is that you can create this other world where, like, in this part of the galaxy, you know, the cosmic force is choosing the Skywalkers. But in this other part of the galaxy, like, there's this whole other family that's front and center. And they're at the center, like, they have their own saga that's attached to them. And right now we're seeing the Skywalkers. And, like, within the universe, it kind of takes them down a couple notches. But, of course, like, from our universe, they are the, you know, the first family of Star Wars. because, like, that's how they were our introduction into this world. And so they'll always kind of have that elevated status no matter what happens.
I'm going to kind of push back on that a little bit just because to Rey and everyone in the galaxy, like, the Skywalkers, especially Luke, is such a myth. And it does kind of show, even in universe, how powerful that bloodline is. And
I completely agree. I guess I just kind of meant, like, in different times and in different worlds, like, the cosmic force is using a lot of different people.
Yes. Yes.
But you're right. Like, the Skywalker name has power in universe, too.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. So, anything you would like to add before we wrap things up?
I really love the Skywalkers. I think they're good people.
They're good-uns.
They're good-uns. And I think they're going to stay good in the end, personally. I really like the legacy of this bloodline. I'm excited for things like Resistance and, like, rewatching Rebels and stuff to get those, like, found family elements too. And I'm really excited. I keep getting more and more excited about Rian Johnson's trilogy and, like, to see this new iteration.
Me too.
And this other new group of people that will have a lot of time to get attached to in the film world. I'm really excited.
Yeah, a trilogy is going to be a really great format, I think, for that.
Yeah,
We're going to really love it. I know we are. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I just kind of want to sum up what we kind of talked about the sequel trilogy and how, you know, we say a lot about how the sequel trilogy, and you said it at the top of the show, like, it can't exist without what came before it. And, you know, Lucasfilm as a whole has been trying really hard to kind of emphasize your blood family, but also your found family. And these two sides are definitely coming together, especially in the sequel trilogy. And it's just continuously being more emphasized with each story that we get here.
That is a great summary.
Thanks.
Lucasfilm approved.
Okay, well, I think this is going to wrap up our show. Thank you guys so much for joining us.
Yes, thank you guys so much. This has been a really fun episode, so let us know what you thought about it. If you want, you can subscribe to us on iTunes or wherever you find your podcasts, Star Wars or otherwise. If you are on any of those platforms like iTunes and you want to leave us a 5-star review, it really does help our show out. So if you have a second and would consider doing that, we would really appreciate it. You can also find us all over the internet and other places too. Our website is skytalkers.com. Our Twitter is @skytalkerspod, and our Instagram Instagram is Skytalkers Podcast. And then we also have our personal Twitters. Charlotte's is at Clarity and mine is at Caitlin Plusher. And then we also have our Patreon if you're interested in looking into that for some extra bonus content from us.
Yes. And I just want to take a moment to thank our amazing patrons. Amy, Neil, Joanna, Cherie, Angela, Diana, Becca, Lynn, Kyle, Katie, Rachel, Courtney, Brad, Brian, Susanna, Megan, Amy, Kelly, Jim, Suara, BJ, Pablo, Kels, Chastity, Alaya, Sarah, Travis, Katie, Daniela, Alyssa, Rebecca, Andy, Delaney, Angela, Allie, Natalia, Daz, Lauren, Serene, Shireen, Matt, Aaron, Edith, Molly, Adam, Stuart, Derek, Connie, Robert, Kirsty, Brandon, and Chuck. Thank you guys so much for supporting us.
Yes, thank you guys so much. We love talking Star Wars with you guys, and we're excited to keep talking Star Wars. So until next time, may the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.